God wants a love affair with you. God will leave the building to roll around in the grass with you. God will leave the building to the builders, to those who want to worship dead stones. And I'm not putting it all down. It's beautiful. We can enjoy it and so forth. God is everywhere. Yes, he'll put up with that. But what is he really like? He wants to play with you the way you are with your kids. We are perfect mirror representations of God. What turns you on about having kids? Having to think about their life insurance, having to start their savings accounts for them, having to make sure they're wearing their clothes correctly? Or do you enjoy rolling around in the lawn with them and tickling them and playing with them and laughing and with a dog and nuzzling each other and laughing and your mind's stopping and there's no thinking and you're just cuddling and loving? Isn't that the moments? Aren't those the moments of bliss with your kids? Well, the same with God. We're made in her image, his image, its image. That's what he enjoys with us. He wants to roll and cuddle and play and make love and have fun and laugh and make silly jokes and just play. He wants to play. God's not interested in the building, in ceremony, ritual. And that's why every teacher has also said that children have a piece of heaven. God does not reveal himself to the prudent and the wise, but to babes. I don't know where it says that in the Bible, but they are hitting on that truth. God does not reveal himself. He doesn't get naked with. He doesn't show himself. He doesn't show up. He doesn't appear. God does not reveal himself to the prudent and the wise, but to babes. But to babes. God has left the building. So once the crazy master, the heart full of love master, once the awake, childlike master has left, then God has left too. God goes where the lover goes. God doesn't stay with a chair that the master used to sit in that's roped off. God doesn't stay at the museum that we're now keeping and saving the relics of. God doesn't keep any of that. He doesn't stay there. God is ever new, present in the moment with new teaching, new expression of his love. Love is the soup, love is the ocean, and it expresses in a million trillion different waves, each one unique and different. It's the same liquid love through it all, you know? God has left the building. And this was a final nail in the coffin for me, in a good way, setting me free, realizing this master just left. We have recordings of him. And here the monks already are killing his message instantly. They're right on top of it. They become librarians. Please, if you're a librarian, it has its role, I understand. But something without the spirit, worshiping the husk, do you get any nourishment from eating the husk of the wheat or the corn, those fibrous leaves around the sweet corn? No, you pull those off and you partake of the sweet fruit, the corn itself, you know? You don't try to eat the husk. You don't preserve it. We're a nation obsessed with preserving crap. We preserve our baby shoes. We formaldehyde things. We have museums. And, you know, it's that feeling you get. Museum head. One of my friends recently said that museum face. You get museum face. Just that horrible look on you. Watch all the people walking through a museum sometime. And you can see them. They're all like, this should be interesting, but I'm bored to death. It's a great expression. We're bored to death. So we have museum face as we walk through these dead museums. Yes, we're dragging around King Tut's dried up corpse. I'm not sure we actually have his mummy, but we're dragging around King Tut's crap. Yeah, it's beautiful crap, but it's crap. It's stuff. It's stuff. King Tut's mask is worth nothing compared to you having moments of ecstasy rolling around in the grass with your baby or with your lover or with your puppy or your dog or your friend or laughing uproariously. God doesn't need any of those riches. They're not riches to him. They're pores. They pour away life energy. They're pourers. They make us poorer. Tutankhamun's mask makes you poorer. It intimidates you. Who cares? Museums are worshiping the dead. Feel the people that are attracted to that, most of them. Who enjoys digging around in old dead bones? Now, if it's giving you the inspiration and activating you to sense across time and connect to something timeless, great. But it's a dangerous practice. Museumitis, worshiping the death, the husk, will eventually kill you if you don't watch it. So I could feel as the monk was talking how insensitive he was. He was not wanting to touch other people. He didn't want to have his heart touch them. He was like desperately, I want my freedom, I hate the world kind of energy, you know? That renunciation, I want to not be part of this horrible world. It's horrible. The world is a piece of crap, piece of shit. It should be flushed. You know, that whole renunciation thing that has happened in spiritual circles where we renounce the world. I'm no longer part of the world. Why try to fix something that's going to be flushed anyway? You must rise above it. Pay no attention to the world. You must suppress your own body. You must suppress your emotions and enter the forever calm and peaceful nothingness. That is death creating religion. And you can tell it by their fruits. Any true master, you can feel because they're consciously present with you. And they love you. Their energy triggers you. You either hate them because you get angry, it stirs up all your stuff, or you fall in love with them. That's what Jesus says. You just don't be lukewarm, you know, either hate me or love me, you know. That means you're paying attention. Otherwise, you're just a walking zombie. And you know what? You're not ready. You're one of the dead. Let the dead bury the dead. So it was heartbreaking to me, which was good. It cracked one of the shells around my heart. A hope that somehow this organization where the master was just there. There's his picture. We have photographs and tapes and we can see him. Surely his essence is still pervading this organization, and there's the dead monk already. They're right in, you know? The dead keepers of the faith. Don't keep the faith. It's like taking a beautiful lion and sticking it in a cage, you know? But it's just inevitable. But God has left the building. When God has left the building, you need to leave the building, or else you're going to start worshiping the building. And worshiping stone is a graven image. Quit worshiping the buildings. Kabir, the famous, I think, 11th, 12th century saint, simple cobbler. There's various stories. He was a weaver or a cobbler, who cares, right? He was a simple man, not schooled, but he loved God. Him and God had a love affair. They were lovers. They were players. They were playmates. They would do jokes with each other, little miracles. Things would happen. Great miracles, you know. And the Orthodox priests, of course, were threatened by this. Here's a simple, unlettered guy. He's a simple shoe guy. He makes our shoes for us. He's the stupid guy, the unlettered guy sitting in his stall, and he has a better connection to God than we do. The priests were threatened, just like they were threatened by Jesus. Just like priests today will be threatened. If any Jesus comes again right now, they'll be intrigued and they'll be threatened. You know? So Kabir was this unlettered, simple cobbler, pounding, making shoes for people. And he found God. And he used to just sing songs of love to God, you know. I meet you in the water, I don't find you in the ancient statues. The ancient statues are dead, but in the living water, when I wash myself, I feel your hand and your love in the water touching my body. That's so funny. I have a little bell going off. The fan came on and moved my little bell. That's what you heard in the background. It's just the spirits playing with us. That's very cute. We can have this stuff manifest. So as I'm talking about God manifesting in the water for Kabir, God touching and caressing him. See, and it mixes, it becomes erotic. It's innocent erotica, which is the final step home when you become innocent in sexuality, where sex is back with God, where you literally have sex with God. It's all one thing, your heart, your genitals, your mind, your hands, your all of it is one lovemaking machine exchange with God. That's one of the final steps home. So Kabir is sharing this, and of course the priests want to get rid of him because this is dangerous. It's too simple. It's the people can't handle this. Yes, 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 he may have found God, but most people can't. This is an exception, and they need us to slowly bring them along, to teach them the exercises and keep them stupid, just like the monk I saw last night. You sit in your chairs, and he kept saying, this is what people do wrong. This is what people do wrong. This is what people do wrong. How about telling us what we to do right? Share with us the love, not the negatory. So Kabir, the priests hatch a scheme to get rid of him. The priests of the town. In India, it's a big thing that teachers often feed the multitudes. You know, a guru or an ashram or a priest will put on a festival where they feed. It's like God's love. It's the fishes and the loaves story with Jesus. It's where God feeds us. He feeds us spiritually, but he also feeds us physically. Now, Kabir was just a poor shoemaker. So the priests hatch a devious scheme where they put out little invitations and flyers all over town, little signs saying, Kabir, the master, you know, has promised to feed the multitudes. He's having a big God feast on such and such a day. All are invited, blah, blah, blah. And they know that thousands will come. And they also know that there's no way that Kabir could possibly feed these people. He has no money. He lives hand to mouth. He lives as a shoemaker, and he has a family and a wife. And, you know, he just lives like the poor people of today live, paycheck to paycheck. Now, Kabir happens to be out of town. He has traveled on some travel. On that weekend, somehow, God arranges it so that he doesn't see these posters. Actually, they take advantage of that too, so that when he comes back, he will not have known even about this. So he'll be a complete surprise. But he's gone. And when the day comes for this feast, all the thousands of people show up to be fed at the town square or whatever they had said it would happen. And there is Kabir. There he is with pots of food and he's in tables and he personally serves every single person that came that day. He serves them all with love, with genuine caring, with food, as he delivers the food to each person. It is what they like the best. Beautiful banquet. It is completely nourishing and fills all the people. The priests are amazed. How could he possibly do this? Cooks it all, everything, pots, da da da. Kabir arrives back in the town the next day, having no knowledge of what had happened. It was God himself that took the form of Kabir. For God so loved Kabir, and Kabir so loved God, that God took care of him completely, implicitly. And God himself assumed the form of Kabir and served all the people. Because of the simple, unlettered, romantic love. Read his songs. Songs of Kabir is a translation, I think, by Tagore, Rabindranath Tagore. Another story about how God has left the building. These miracles would just happen around Kabir, various things. His love would overflow, and then it would touch others. It was overflowing, and others would receive grace from it. Healings would inevitably and naturally happen. The word got out. People would come around. The priests couldn't contain it. They couldn't shut him down. So a following started up around him. Now, in India, for a long time, there's been Muslims and Hindus, and that's why Pakistan and Bangladesh separated, because they're Muslim states, and so there's that fighting. The Muslims will fight the Hindus because the Hindus, Muslims are a propagational religion. They want others to do what they tell them, like Christianity does. So it's a perfect match for Muslims and Christians to fight each other, because the Muslims are also conversionists. They want to convert people to you, and the Christians do the same thing. Hindus don't do that. But so anyway, at the time, Kabir had both Muslim followers, Mohammedans at the time, they were called probably, and Hindu followers. So he had this mixture of students, because God is bigger than all those delineations and silly sectarianism. So he had students from every, he didn't care. So God loves us all. We're all children of God. Let's sing some songs. Right? So when he leaves his body, when he dies, immediately his students, the Muslim students and the Hindu students, start arguing about what to do with the body. One of them wants it cremated and one of them wants it buried. I forget which is which. It's holy. It's a holy rule, you know. Oh, it needs to be cremated. That's what God wants. Blah, blah, blah. No, 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 it needs to be buried. So the students are fighting. The Mohammedan students, the Muslim students are fighting with the Hindu students of Kabir. And one wants them buried and one wants them cremated. And they don't know what to do. They can't cut the body in half. So anyway, as they've been arguing, the story goes, when they open the casket or unwrap the body again, the body is gone. There goes the bell again. That's sweet. The body is gone, and in its stead are flowers. His body is turned into flowers. half the flowers go to the Muslims and they can cremate it as they want, and half of it goes to the Hindus and they can bury it. I think it's the other way around. So they get what they want. But immediately, even the body is not even cold. The body is not even cold. And the students are arguing. So, God has left the building. When God has left the building, go with him. God has left the building to us. He's okay with that. But if you're not a spirit that enjoys the building, that enjoys the librarianism, that wants to keep track of the records and catalog and Dewey Decimal and this and that and scrape the bones and catalog them and put them in museums, if that's not interesting to you, don't get caught in it. Because God himself is very seldom a visitor to the museums. My whole life, whenever I go in museums, I feel drained. I feel like I want to drop to the floor. It's just so draining. It's like this giant life suck energy that just sucks the energy out of you. That's why I laughed so much the other day, my friend said. It's that museum face. We all get museum face when we're bored. Right? Yeah. It's the similar thing that happens in board meetings. That's why they call them that. It's bored. They're bored. It's horrible. So, if God has left the building, you can too. I almost walked out of the review of the meditation techniques yesterday, but I didn't want to create a disturbance. And I'm asking God, do you want me to create a disturbance? I will. I'll stand up and say it right then and there. But there's a right time and place for that. And in the past, I've been a real stir-upper and destroyer and radical truth-teller. And so part of my journey right now is to listen, because there is a right time to hold back and acquiesce and allow the crazy museum curators to curate the teaching. They're curing the teaching, meaning they're killing it. It's being cured. It's like curing a ham. It's being cooked. They're cooking the teachings into something dead. God has left the building. Why don't you leave with him? Why don't you hold his hand and go where he's going? God has left the building. There's no way around this. There's no way around this. Our current civilization is doomed to failure. Until we learn to flow with God, until we learn to run with God. Have you ever run? So few of us probably actually have done it. But think of the times when you held your lover's hand, your best friend's hand. I see two girls doing it right now. Just in my mind, I can just see. It's like on a beach somewhere. And they're young. They're young. I don't want to put age on them. And they're friends. And they're running barefoot in the sand. They're just running together. The two girls. Beautiful, wild, unkempt hair. No makeup necessary. And they're just enjoying running with each other, laughing, splashing. So when God takes your hand and he wants to run on the beach with you, when he wants to run outdoors, when he wants to get up out of the pew and leave the building, why don't you leave the building with him? And leave the building to others.
All All talks from the Awakening Soul series are available at soulcounseling.com.